What's up, everyone? Welcome to Let's Play The Ball. This is a first-person puzzle game. We're going to be getting all of the secrets in the game. More on all that stuff in a little bit, though. Once we've gotten the opening cutscene out of the way, it's not going to be a terribly cutscene or story-heavy game, but there is some cool stuff set up early on. Just got to get the opening scene out of the way, so let's start that up. Separated from your friend, you find yourself trapped in a cavern. On your own until help arrives, you decide to explore. It is here where you find a strange artifact. You take it. This triggers a massive door to open. Startled, you enter and discover a strange device. The only word that comes to mind is ball. Despite your reservations, curiosity gets the better of you. You progress deeper into the earth as the air becomes stagnant and hot. Okay, so all we really got from that is that we are on some sort of archaeological dig or an expedition, something to that effect, as many horror stories start out. Just gonna go ahead and lower that sensitivity so everyone doesn't get motion sickness. Oh man, this really flaccid ball. Okay, so this is the ball, even though we have not gotten the ball yet, or any way to manipulate said ball. I wish I could press H to turn the help messages off. Anyway, I said I was going to be getting all of the secrets in this run. Not specifically 100%, even though the secrets are really the only things tracked. Well, monkeys are too, but I don't know how many monkeys there are on each level, so I'm going to exclude those. It's also super hard to find out via videos, because every time you search for the ball monkeys, you get super monkey ball returns. So it might be a bad idea for this LP if no one can actually find this. Oh well. I like the game well enough. It's worth it. God damn, look how cool this thing is. If Spawn were in a first-person physics puzzler, this is what he would use. And this thing is straight out of the 90s. I love it. Looks so cool. Actually, it kind of looks... Oh, man. This kind of looks like Johnson and all of his various gun forms from Shadows of the Damned. This is a first-person Shadows of the Damned, if that was a puzzle game. Yeah, here it is. Now we're finally gonna get introduced to the ball. Finally, like it's been like for 2 hours into the game. Alright. So the numbers that you saw, well, the one number above my health that you saw was the distance we were from the ball. And that's going to, as soon as this help message finally disappears, that's gonna keep recurring and showing us our distance from the ball. It's going to become pretty relevant for a couple of puzzles. Mainly, though, it's just to let you know where the ball is in relation to you, so you can keep track of it. And the gun that we're using to manipulate it has two primary functions. If you right-click it, it will create suction, and it will suck only the ball towards you. If you use the left click, and if you hold that down, it charges up, and you can push objects further and further away from you, depending on how long you hold the button down for. A large majority... Is there a secret over here? I can't remember. A large majority of the game is going to be spent doing button puzzles. We have two kinds of buttons we can hit. We can hit the button with the ball, or we can hit this human icon. The ball can only hit the ball icon. We can only hit the people icon. Pretty simple. The ways that we are going to have to control the ball and maneuver the ball, that is going to be where we get a lot of our cool variety from.
Mankind took the ball from them, the source of their mysterious power. They taught man many things, how to build, how to tame the land, and harness the seas. But when their children betrayed them, they guided man no longer. They recoiled and became angry, became vengeful. Mankind prayed that they would never find the ball.
Mojo Jojo! Let's go run him down. There are a ton of monkeys in the game, like I said, that you can run down and kill. They splatter nicely. Rest in peace, Mojo Jojo. It does track the monkeys down here. We have one killed, but it doesn't tell you how many there are total, like the secrets. And in the first level here, we have 0 out of 4 found. I believe there is one if we break this wall down. I think that's where the first one is. It's either this or you break the wall down for the first, or one of the earlier puzzle sequences. Yeah, that's what this is. It was the door directly opposite this one, so we will go and grab the first secret over here down this hallway. Hop up here. Not a very well hidden secret. They get way more elaborate directly after this one. Not even gonna try to pronounce that. The men came to the village and brought us to where the ground burns. I was afraid, but my husband only smiled and took me by the hand. It's a gift, he told me. A gift that will make you happy. They led us beyond the lakes of fire, into halls made of metal, halls that moved and spoke. We were terrified. We didn't understand, but we trusted them. The story of the game, the background details are almost exclusively told through those secrets. The main plot of the game, though, it's pretty bare bones. The plot progression that we do get, though, it's pretty nuts, especially the ending. I look forward to seeing that again. I haven't seen that in a good couple of years. I hope it instills the amount of what the fuck happened as it did the first time I saw it. Let's see, where's the opening around here? There's another secret almost directly after the first one. Here it is. It's a very devilishly hidden hole in that bridge. Father placed my palm upon the device. I did not know what it was, but I knew that no man could have forged it. They had built it. When it was over, thoughts were placed in my mind that had not been there before. I was no longer afraid of the machine, which had before seemed like monsters. I did not know how I could have ever feared them, or anything. With it placing thoughts in your head, the way that's phrased, it makes me think of Welcome to Night Vale. The pyramid that places questions in the heads of some and answers in others. Welcome to Night Vale is a really underappreciated podcast. Even though the longer it goes on, the more I'm seeing critical acclaim for it, and well-deserved critical acclaim. One of the best podcasts I've heard in a very long time, and I'm kind of a podcast junkie. This puzzle right here, you have to get the ball over the switch long enough for the elevator to lower, then pull it off. The elevator will lead you up here. Third secret in a row. All the secrets in this level are pretty easy, except for the fourth one. We tested our new minds. We had to discover a way to lave water from the underground for all the thirsty mouths burdened with constructing the Altepetl. Convoys of water bearers between the worksites took able arms away from the build. So we set out to construct a new system. But we were left frustrated. Our troughs failed. A whole month was wasted. Sounds like it's before the advent of aquifers or aqueducts. So the ball here is a first-person physics puzzle game where you use a unique specialized gun in order to solve puzzles in the environment. Sound familiar? Almost like the Kim Swift trifecta of Narbacular Drop, Portal, and Quantum Conundrum. This can be a little bit tricky if you are not watching your step and you don't see the drop. Like I was saying though, the Kim Swift games and the ball function pretty differently, but it's an easy analogy to make. They're similar enough. Oh man, we have killed two monkeys with one ball. I think I got the third monkey. Were there three monkeys? I thought I counted three. Oh man, we killed all of the monkeys. They were too busy singing to put anybody down. I'm gonna try to name every monkey. I'm gonna be like Saxton Hill. A monkey will be killed every episode. What was the Saxton Hill bit? A gorilla will be stabbed on every page or something. In every issue, a gorilla will be stabbed. Man, I want to go back and read all those Saxton Hill and TF2 comics. This is the room with the secret that is a real, real pain for me to get to. I might die a bunch here trying to get to it, so I'll hold off any further explanations. This is a little bit tricky. Yeah, I think... Yeah! That's why. I am terrible at this. So I am gonna cut to the successful attempt, because you can see it leaves me back here, and this could actually take a few tries, because I am not crazy good at this. One interesting thing to note, though, before I do cut ahead, when you fail a puzzle, it starts you back at a checkpoint, but it saves your progress on a puzzle. So you see, I don't have to hit those switches anymore. And the spike pit in the room stays lowered. Okay. Just gotta do it a little bit more carefully this time. Okay, jump forward. Just a tiny little bit, just kind of like... Not even inch your way forward, centimeter your way forward. And when you're in the air, jumping a little bit forward, you just tap the suction so it sees you in midair, a little bit ahead of the ball, and it drags the ball forward across the spikes. You land on it, keeps rolling. The thing is, you just have to keep aware of your position on the ball, because the ball keeps rolling forward and you're on it, you can actually roll off run of it, and I got it. Drought. I sat upon the silt and beat my tool against the dirt. There must be a better way, I thought. Our eyes were open, but our minds were hungry. We built faster than our bodies could follow. I sat in solitude and conjured, peering into the cavity I dug in the ground. A solution came to me. We built a conduit from clay and ceramic. Water flowed. Okay, now part two, getting back. This one's not quite as bad, especially since I've actually done this now one time. Oh no, I jumped too far back. Shit. Okay, well, that's fine. Starts us right back here. What was that? I think I saw four deaths? I thought that was only three. Oh well, it's not too bad. I always have a hard time with that little mini puzzle. That little bit of platforming. First person platforming in general is not great, but yeah, that's fine. The nice thing though, it starts us right here. And this is where we need to be anyway, because if you saw, there's this little doorway for us. Yeah, it would be a pain if every time you died you had to traverse the bed of spikes anew, but you don't, so it's fine. Alright, so let's pick off where I left off. pick up where I left off explaining about the ball and its origins, because I actually find it pretty interesting the way this game came to be. The ball took second place in the Make Something Unreal contest back in 2008. And Make Something Unreal is a sponsored contest by Epic that rewards developers for coming up with really awesome Unreal mods or games. And the first ever Make Something Unreal contest was a $1 million contest sponsored by Nvidia in 04 or 05, 04. It was 2004. And the first place winner was Red Orchestra, which was, if you're not familiar with that game, it's a total conversion mod for Unreal Tournament. And it's a very realism-focused World War II FPS. And that got Tripwire $50,000 for winning first place. And that later got fleshed out into a full game, into a full series, actually. Red Orchestra 2 just came out a couple years ago, I believe. And coincidentally, this game, after taking second place in 2008, wound up getting picked up by Tripwire. And it was then published in either 2009 or 2010. I want to say it was 09. I don't remember playing this in 2010. I've only played through it one time, unfortunately. Hey, that's what the Let's Play is for, though. That's the cool thing about doing the Let's Plays, among many other things, like developing my ability as a speaker and all that cool stuff, and getting to interact with you guys. The other nice thing about it is sometimes it just gives me an excuse to go back and revisit old games that I've been meaning to get around to doing replays of for a long time. Stuff like Brutal Legend. Like, I probably wouldn't have found time to go back and do a second playthrough of Brutal Legend, even though I wanted to for such a long ass time, had it not been for the Let's Play. And I enjoy this game quite a bit. It's a really fun, unique physics puzzle game with a really nice inventive mechanic. It's fresh is what it is. The first half of it is a little bit easy, and that's really all that's even close to wrong with it, since it's a pretty short game in total, but I like it. I like it a lot. It also has some cool little bonus modes like survival. You might have saw that on the main menu. I'll try to show that off at some point if I remember to. There's even a Portal themed level in here, come to think of it, because this was part of the Potato Sack, which was which itself was a bundle of indie games that was part of an ARG leading up to the release of Portal 2. A lot of connections with Portal here, aside from just mechanics and genre. Okay, so we have a couple more blocks to push out here. I wish I had done the second room first. That low gravity room is pretty cool. We'll be seeing more of that later on, though. It's a little bit minimalist in the systems available, but we've seen a ton of what we're going to see. It's just going to get... The systems that have been introduced to us so far are going to be used in more elaborate ways as the game progresses, as you might expect. It's nice, though. It makes it a little bit tighter than some other games that just focus on throwing tons and tons of different things at you all the time, and then you go into the late game and they halfway through introduced everything they can throw at you, but they haven't really thought out really interesting, innovative ways to use all of the things they've thrown at you once you hit the halfway mark, and then from then on it just kind of drags. This game doesn't really do that, because it keeps finding new, fresh ways for you to use its mechanics, for you to interact with it. Keeps it feeling fun. Plus, it doesn't overstay its welcome, like I said. That's typically the best way I can think to defend short games, is sometimes with a 12-hour game, tends to last too long. You get games that don't really need to be 12 hours that are, and it's like 5 hours of padding. This game, it's about 5-6 hours long, but it's 5-6 hours of, like, never feeling like it's gone on too long. Doesn't overstay its welcome. And I've meandered enough for this episode. Thanks for watching, everyone. If you liked the video, be sure to leave it a thumbs up. Leave me a comment. I read all of them. Respond to most of them if the comment's open-ended enough. And also make sure to subscribe if you haven't already. And if you want more awesome daily gaming videos I upload every single day, click my name to check the channel out and all of my videos and playlists. Thanks for watching, everyone. Take it easy. Have a good one.